Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, and by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Mobil Corporation, Essex Chemical, and the Friends of Firing Line.
From a Democratic media consultant who tries and sometimes succeeds in defeating Bill Buckley's favorite candidates for public office. Today on Firing Line, we're going to debate the case and the cause of a missionary priest who died 200 years ago. When I was in high school in Los Angeles, I had friends who went to a school across town named for Junipero Serra. In fact, there are hundreds of schools, streets, community centers named for Father Serra, a Franciscan missionary who founded a string of missions on the California coast, starting with San Diego in 1769. Growing up in California, learning California history as it was then taught, no one seemed less objectionable or more admirable than Father Serra. That is the version of history still read in the Vatican, which in the 1980s has taken two of the three canonical steps toward the canonization of Father Serra, the declaration that he is a saint, one of the few thousand the Catholic Church has ever officially proclaimed to be in heaven. In the midst of this process, other voices have been heard, insisting that Father Serra was not a saint but a sinner, that he and the Franciscan missionaries he brought to California oppressed rather than protected the Indians, engaged in forced conversions and forced labor, that Father Serra was less Francis of Assisi and more Torquemada the Inquisitor. That view has been insistently argued by our first guest, the historian Edward Castillo, himself a descendant of Mission Indians, whose efforts to debunk Father Serra and the Franciscans has enlisted a number of adherents, ranging from Indian rights advocates to a handful of Catholic priests. On the other side is Father Noel Maholy, who has spent 40 years of his life promoting the canonization of Father Serra, and who recently led 500 Americans to Rome to see Pope John Paul II declare the Franciscan missionary blessed, the last step before sainthood. Now let me start the discussion off with a question for Mr. Buckley. Bill, as a faithful Catholic, do you think it's possible that the Catholic Church and Pope John Paul II are about to fallibly confer sainthood on the wrong man?
Well, there is no canon, no mandate, no warranty that I know of, subject to correction here, that says that infallibly the Pope makes the correct selection. It was only 10 years ago that a few saints who had been canonized were discovered historically never to have existed. But I was a little bit arrested by Mr. Shrum's statement that Father Serra was a sinner. I don't know of anybody who isn't a sinner, and I don't know of any saint who is not a sinner, so he must have meant something extra theological by saying that. Why don't we begin, Father Maholy, by stating the reason why there should be such advocacy on the matter of Father Serra. Why have you devoted so much of your life to his beatification? What difference does it make?
Well, the direct reply to your question is very simple. I was teaching sacred theology just like Padre Junipero Serra, and I was told to take over his cause as vice postulator and proceed from there. And in those days, we didn't question superiors. We just did what we were told. So I took it over and have been with it ever since, actually 30 years.
Well, have you been in it with internal assent?
There was some discussion among the friars after Vatican II. Some had misinterpreted the decrees of Vatican II as though we said the implication was we are going to water down this type of thing, and this is a triumphalism and all that sort of emphasis. And then with the advent of John Paul II, it's certainly evident that it's not contrary to Vatican II, because he's beatified and canonized more saints than any of his predecessors.
Oh, wait, I meant to ask you a slightly different question, namely, you began by telling us that you, in effect, were following orders yeah. when you were told to become an advocate, much yeah. as a lawyer might follow yeah. orders if he was instructed to. Oh. But I asked whether internal assent, oh. I meant, are you completely yourself sold oh. on the correctness yeah. of your cause?
If at any time I became convinced that Father Junipero Serra was not a saint in his own day and in his death, I would have asked to be relieved of the job, because there are too many valuable things to be done and important things to be done, and I wouldn't want to waste my time. That would be the argument, that I wouldn't want to waste my time on something that is nugatory or would end in defeat.
Well, Professor Castillo, should I say Castillo or Castillo?
Castillo.
Sorry. Just to get a little perspective here, are you protesting the canonization of Junipero Serra in your capacity as a Christian, or merely in your capacity as a Californian, or both?
Well, I'm concerned about the canonization of Serra principally because of the allegations that have been made concerning the benefits of the Christian mission system on the California Indians. I'm a direct descendant of mission Indians from California. And we know from our family histories, from the oral traditions that have passed down through our families, and the fact that I studied California history, I'm convinced that the system that he established here was not of benefit to the Indians. While I don't propose to tell the church what to do, and by the way, I'm not a Christian, I'm a pagan, and what I don't propose to tell that church what to do, but I am concerned about the portrayal of the benefits of the mission system for the Indians.
Well, I think we can have an independent curiosity about your objections without your being a Christian. But as the lawyers would put it, you really have no standing, do you? That is to say, it's none of your business who the church canonizes. I'm not being an Englishman. I might be intellectually curious about any war over the legitimacy of the successor to the Queen, but I wouldn't feel that I had a personal interest in it. So why don't you let Catholics and Protestants and Jews and non-pagans do their own thing in their own way?
I suppose that would be fine as long as they did it without alleging that benefits accrued to the Indians of California. That was not the case. The legacy of Serra.
But anybody can allege the truth under the First Amendment as long as it doesn't bind other citizens to compliance in that history. You can go ahead and be anti-Serra for the rest of your life, and Father Maholy is not going to disturb you, nor
will
the
true.
Pope.
That's true.
Or might he send some submarines up here to
no telling.
Shoot at you?
But when he writes books making allegations that the plantation mission type system that was established in California benefited Indians, and I know otherwise, then I feel it's my right to speak
okay,
out.
Okay, but this has nothing to do with canonization. In other words, if they elected, if the Catholic Church nominated him for saint or for Pope Marquet, it would have no bearing whatsoever on the historical question, as far as you're concerned. So why should you attempt to obstruct a process that falls outside of your correct jurisdiction?
Well, I think it's every citizen's right to have an opinion on something. And
gee, I really don't. I don't see why I should tell. I don't see why I should lecture the Jews, let's say, on who should be the chief rabbi. I might prefer him to him, but I don't think it ought to become a cause militant of mine. I don't mean to kill this program, but having made that point there, I really don't think it's any of your business. Let's discuss whether or not, assuming that there were no canonization in prospect, we're glad or sorry that Junipero Serra lived. You're sorry, right?
I'm sorry that he came to California.
Yeah. And you're sorry that he came to California because he did what to the Indians?
He established a system of missions along the coast that was primarily relied upon the military, Spanish military, and I think this is a part of the history that's unfortunately been left out, relied heavily on the Spanish military to establish its authority in California, extend its church empire.
Why does that surprise you?
It doesn't surprise me.
If it doesn't surprise you, why did you bring it up?
Well, I bring it up because I'm concerned that the canonization process has made allegations that this process benefited Indians, and I know otherwise.
Well, are we going to argue that any culture which was interfered with by another culture was diminished by that experience? Are we going to argue that the blacks in the South were hurt in virtue of being taken from Africa to South Carolina?
If you were a black, you may.
If I were black, I may. It seems to me that your the notion that no culture should ever be disturbed is a kind of a discomforting thought and entirely inconsistent with what I understand to be the superintending instruction of Christ, which was to go out and teach the people in the ways of the Lord. Now, if you feel that Christ was a bad influence, then anybody who was Christianized was hurt. But this would be inconsistent with not only your position, but the historical position, is that right?
That's correct. What prompted the missionaries was Christ's mandate to go forth and make disciples of all nations. Mm-hmm. Now, the question before the House is not canonizing the mission system. The question is, this individual, what kind of a life did he lead? And to stick with the mission system for a moment, had not the Spanish come into California, what prompted them to move after 2 years of holding title to that land was the Russian threat from on top. And if the Russians hadn't come down with whatever civilization they would have brought, surely the British would have come in. And then we might have a repetition of what happened in Massachusetts when the year that Padre Junipero Serra was born, they were getting $20 a scalp in Massachusetts for Indian scalps.
Well, but what if the Russians hadn't, then as now, gotten in our way? Wouldn't there still have been a justification for a military support of missionary activity?
Oh, sure. Judgment? But the military support was incidental. I mean, the handful of soldiers. California was the most populous area of the contiguous United States at that time, a population estimated anywhere from 250,000 to 1,000,000 Indians. Had they risen up, they could have pushed that handful of Spanish soldiers into the ocean and a handful of missionaries.
Well, and the Mexicans could have done that to Cortes also,
yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
But what I want to understand is, are we being invited to object categorically in the fashion of Margaret Mead to any culture moving in and implanting its own culture over that which was there before?
No, I've never made that contention, and I'm quite aware of the history of the other areas of impact, cultural impact, the French, the English, and others. What concerns many thoughtful people is the fact that this particular colonization was clothed and shrouded in religious motivations and others, which today, I mean, would be shocking to people if we want to argue that.
Well, but so. We don't want to use today's perspective, do we? The perspective during several centuries, which perspective brought very bloody wars, religious wars, was that it was the corporate duty of a state to go out and colonize. And to colonize meant also to, in those days, to Christianize. The Puritans understood this to be a mandate to take whatever Indians they could find and teach them a different way of life and teach them to worship a different God. Are you saying that this was all a grievous historical miscalculation?
No, I just think it's sad that we are dealing with it in the 20th century now because of the canonization process. Again, history is brought up, and if we're going to accept Serra as an example to 20th century and future generations of Christians, then I think that the whole story should come out.
Well, I've read your material, and you point to a lot of atrocities committed by a lot of missionaries, which I don't doubt, because everybody commits atrocities, and I join you in deploring them. But I didn't see you point to Junipero Serra as an alleged perpetrator of any atrocities? Or are you not now contending this, or are you simply saying that because he didn't protest the ambient way of doing things, he was, in effect, guilty of participation?
Well, I think he was a man of his time, certainly not a man ahead of his times. He was a reactionary, even by the standards of the 18th century.
How do you define reactionary?
Well, reactionary in the sense that the Enlightenment had begun to affect European thought, especially among the educated classes, and ideas of the dignity of the human being, freedom of religion, the idea that a state-sponsored church may not be in the best interest of people, were all things that he was opposed to. He was a commissioner of the Inquisition.
Well, he died 50 years before the British allowed Catholics to vote. So I don't see why that would make him a reactionary. 60 years before they allowed Jews to vote. It seems to me that in the 18th century, he died in 1784.
Correct.
It seems to me that, I'm trying to understand the sense in which you consider him a reactionary. It's true, he wasn't much influenced by the Virginia resolutions on religious liberty. Nobody in Spain was.
That's true. Spain was
why,
not.
Why does that make him a reactionary?
I think if you look at the culture of Europe and the culture of Catholic Europe, he did.
How do you handle that allegation?
I don't see any necessity for him jumping on the bandwagon, as it were, of the new theories. There are new theories being propagated today in the Catholic Church or around it, and a goodly number are not sold on it at all. I've heard the idea suggested today, for example, that truth can be multiple. Well, the day that that becomes correct, I don't know where we are.
Well, would you say that anybody who would disagree with that was a reactionary?
No. I would like to add also that I'm concerned that that Serra be viewed as everything he did, where you pointed out that I in my work I haven't cited Serra as a person. You can't put a whip in his hand, you can't put a smoking gun in his hand, and that's true. The man was an administrator. A good comparison would be to someone like Dylan Meyer, where he orchestrated a system that eventually resulted in the deaths of 62,000 California Indians.
Now, I don't know who he is.
I don't either. Dylan
Meyer was the administrator of the Japanese internment and later became Commissioner of Indian Affairs.
Oh, he was the guy who followed Earl Warren's orders?
Yes, that's correct.
Does that make Earl Warren a reactionary?
In this particular instance, I think that was pretty reactionary.
And the Supreme Court that authorized it.
You bet. I think it was wrong. Yeah. Then it was wrong.
But. Is it beyond your disposition to imagine the situation to applaud somebody who lived in circumstances very different from those that our own culture is at home with, and point out the utter nobility of his personal life? He was a man who lived in total austerity. He sacrificed a professorship in Palma de Mallorca, taught in Mexico City, came out, was dirt poor throughout his life, and did, according to his lights, the very best that he could for what he called savages, which is the term that was used universally during the 19th century, and perhaps correctly, 18th century, about the Indians.
That's my point of view.
This is not invidious. I'm sure that my great-grandparents were savages, too. But my point is, why oughtn't people to concentrate on the enormous sacrifices that he made in pursuit of what was then acknowledged as the highest ideals, namely living according to the dictates of Christ?
Well, those are culturally defined ideals, and I do not deny that he may have had an austere life. His giving up his professorship may have been tied to the fact that it was discovered by his colleagues had discovered that he had Jewish ancestry, and the Inquisition, the shadow of the Inquisition, was still hung over Europe, and it may have been a career move for him to come to the New World.
A career move intending what, to be canonized in the 20th century and recognition?
No, a career move simply to escape possible retribution.
How do you handle that?
The Well, my personal reaction is, the wonder to me is why the man ever remained in California with the difficulties he had to put up with. That's the heroism. But to answer your question specifically, there was, and unquestionably there is, an Abraham in Serra's ancestry. And that perhaps is the only rational explanation I've ever heard of the delay of accepting him into the order. He was postponed 1 year in acceptance. And Pelot's reasons there always had me wondering. As far as his contemporaries not promoting him at home, he was surely in line for ecclesiastical advancement, perhaps president of the university. To try to keep him home, there was an excommunication against interfering with the vocation to the missions. So the only thing they could do, they offered him a plum of being the vice provincial. Well, that's enough to drive any man to the missions. So Serra wasn't buying that at all. He was felt a call to the missions, and he resorted to prayer before he made the decision. He realized he was giving up not only something that was a personal advancement, but likewise a distinction for the order and an honor for the order.
You're talking about when he was in Spain or
when he was in Spain, when he held the prayer at the University of Mallorca. And so he said, rather than do it impulsively, he made a novena to Our Lady under the title of the Immaculate Conception, to whom he was devoted, and San Francisco Solano, who had been the apostle to South America, who had been canonized during his lifetime.
So your point is that there was a consistent self-abnegation.
Oh, it was always a supernatural motive. Yeah.
And in what way did the fact that he had Jewish blood influence his conduct? Only in the sense that it delayed his acceptance by the order?
I have not seen the actual evidence of Jewish blood yet in the documentation. The Mallorcan documentation is just coming to the fore now, and there may be something therein. So I suspend judgment there. But the fact that there was an Abraham mentioned in his ancestry or in his genealogy raised the eyebrows, at least, of the provincial who was accepting it.
And of course, this was during a period when the practice of the Jewish religion was not tolerated.
Yes, or certainly wasn't universally accepted.
Well, that am I correct that it wasn't until 1942 that the Jewish religion could be practiced in Spain?
I'm uncertain of that.
As a matter of fact, I'm not. I'm quite certain of it. So, in spite then of a series of disadvantages, and in spite of an ascendancy that was waiting for him in another direction, he chose this. He chose to live a life of self-sacrifice.
That's right.
In order to attempt to Christianize, and among other things, to lift the hygienic standards of the Indians with whom he associated. Is that correct?
Yeah. It all went together.
Quite apart from the fact that he Christianized them, are you saying that the civilization introduced by the Spanish in the 18th century was not at a higher level than that contemporaneously practiced by the Indians?
Depends on what you consider a higher level of culture. You know, we're, unfortunately, history is judges cultures by the size of the buildings they leave, pretty much. And if we look at culture's abilities to meet the basic needs of their people, to feed them, honoring life, then I think it's up for question.
Spiritual hunger is a basic need of a people. That's recognized.
I'm sorry.
Spiritual hunger is a basic need of a people, something
true.
Recognized not only by Christians but also by pagans, or most
That's
pagans.
That's true. I agree.
And so he attempted to account for that particular hunger.
Well, he kept native religious leaders chained and whipped like dogs.
Comment?
I've never seen any evidence that Serra chained any religious leader of the Indians and whipped him like a dog.
Comment?
There is documentation that he ordered shackles to be sent to the mission in San Diego.
Well, shackles was everywhere, weren't they?
Not among the native cultures.
Well, I don't know what I don't know how the Indians treated naughty boys. In London, they were hanging them if they stole anything worth more than sixpence. So I can't imagine that shackles was considered a barbarous atavistic instrument in the 18th century.
When there was an Indian uprising in San Diego, and several Spaniards were killed, Father Juniper saw the governor leave Monterey to go to San Diego to discipline and survey the situation. Immediately, he wrote a letter to the viceroy imploring mercy for the
gentlemen,
ones that were imprisoned.
Gentlemen, we're out of time. I must say this is one of the few subjects in which I have ever agreed with my fellow sinner, Bill Buckley. It seems to me that the complaint here is more with the coming of the Europeans in general than with the specific conduct of Father Serra, who may have mitigated the suffering of the Indians. It also seems to me that this is fundamentally an irresolvable debate. Professor Castillo's indictment of Father Serra is that he did not leave the Indians pagan, which is precisely why the Catholic Church is in the process of canonizing him. But I'll leave the last word where it belongs with Mr. Buckley.
Well, in the course of researching the question, I saw a story in the San Diego Union, the headline of which was the Ad Hoc Serra Outrage Committee, a loose network of Indians and leftists and atheist groups will sponsor a march. I suppose one ought not to object to anybody marching against anybody for any reason, but it does strike me as an extraordinarily extrinsic appetite of a group to attempt to interfere with the workings of an established religious order on whether or not somebody, a historical figure, deserves special distinction. We live in an age in which anti-colonialism is itself a religion, but it's also an age in which, for instance, in the continent of Africa, there are only two self-ruling countries, and in which the number of martyrs and refugees vastly exceed in the last 15 years what could be pointed to during the last 200 years. So, in general, I'm in sympathy with what Junipero did, and I tend to take your word for it, since you're a man of the cloth, that he deserves it. Thank you.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, and by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Mobile Corporation, Essex Chemical, and the Friends of Firing Line. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $3 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program, and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SICA, which is solely responsible for its content.